introduce yourself whenever you're ready.
Hi, I'm Andrew Hatch. I'm a sports performance intern at Marquette University for the summer of 2019. Here's my annual plan for a wakeboard. So here we have a quick video about what wakeboarding is. This is just kind of show you what it is, kind of what they do during the sport. So the organization that kind of runs a professional and upper level wakeboarding is the World Wakeboarding Association. So they have, the way wakeboarding works is they have 360 to 460 meters in which a boat is going to pull the athlete on the wakeboard through this course, and they have between the buoys, again, that 360 to 460 meters, to perform as many tricks as they can. And again, jumping over weights, sometimes there's obstacles to perform tricks on, sometimes it's just the wake from the boats. The boat pulls at about 24 miles per hour. So as they go through, it's about 15 seconds once through. The boat will turn them around, and they go back through the course. That's one run. So they'll have two runs in the competition. So in total, they compete for about 30 seconds between the buoy. If you're going to add up the time between, it's about a minute to a minute and a half where they're being pulled. So as you can see here, they go up on the waist. They get some pretty good height when they go up, and they got to perform as many tricks as they can. But emphasizing quality over quantity, it's better to do some crazy flips and twists and turns than just going up and doing simple 160s as many, or 360s as many times as you can throughout the time period that you're allowed. So the focus of the training will be on the core, which is really good for really emphasizing their stability while they're on the board, staying on the water, again, obviously not crashing, staying upright, but also for as you're jumping up in the air, you can be able to twist, turn, bring your legs up, flip over. So all that's going to start from the core, bringing your knees up, keeping your head stable, keeping your shoulders back. All starts in the middle and then works out. So that's going to be very important, along with the shock absorption. As you see, they land, sometimes they can get 15 feet up in the air. Hitting that water isn't very soft. Again, they're landing on a board. It's not like they're sinking and coming back up. They're hitting that water and staying flat. So they're getting that shock absorption, so they're not just jarring their spine, lower back, and ankle and knees every time they land. Next will be muscular endurance. So that's going to more focus on the grip and being able to hold this position for, again, that minute and a half where they're being pulled. It's not something where they should get jarred, but they have to hold, maintain that grip, hold that position while including all these jumps and flips. It's going to get tiring over a minute and a half. Even though it looks like you're just being pulled, arms straight, they have to have a little attention so their shoulders aren't being pulled out of their sockets. This is where the strength comes in. As you can see, they do have some build to them, so they're not just massive people. They're moving mostly just their body weight. But again, to be able to hold that position in kind of a semi-squat, you're not squatting all the way down, but once you get up in the air, being able to move that board, pull yourself in and out, do flips, it's going to take some strength so you're able to kind of do all the things you need to do. And then power, so this is mainly for getting up in the air. Just going over the wake isn't going to get you that high. So a big point, you got to add a little jump, kind of bend the knees, jump up a little bit. You don't really see it while they're in the competition, but there's some power aspect of getting up off the water. So just an example for the core exercises. Again, the plank, just to build that stability so they can stay up straight. I have the leg raises for, I think that's a good one for when they're up on the board, that'll sit up in the air. That simulates getting their knees up if they're doing a turn, staying in the air as much time as possible to get the maximum amount of time to perform as many tricks as they can. And then it's sort of like the twisting motion. That'll help when they're in the air. So when they're reaching behind their back to grab the board, they're turning their torso, but maybe not their legs at the same time. So again, using that core to turn your body and then ride it at the right time so you can later successfully perform the tricks. And then just some strength and power exercises. A lot of this is body weight. It's a good, you need a strength body weight ratio. So you're not really moving weights much. Mostly the exercises are body weights. We have some rings here, some ring inverted rows again, just for simulating pulling yourself in the ring or pulling yourself up while you're being pulled, pushing yourself back. Some single leg squats, just to get used to that position of being preseason is the beginning of December to the last week in January, and the end season, which is the longest period of time, would be the first full week in February to July. So obviously they're out in the water, so it's a summer sport. They're not doing much in the winter. Some people go out on the oceans. This is usually more done in lakes where the water is a little calmer. You don't have massive waves coming over. So you're just kind of going over what the board leads you. So again, it's more common to see this in summer. Over here we have, I believe, August from the WWA webpage. So this is the average week that a wakeboarder would have. So you see competitions are always on the weekend, usually Friday, Saturday, sometimes Saturday, Sunday, or longer. There's 4 days at the end that's national, so that's obviously going to be a few more days. So usually they have the days off during the week to train and then go into competitions on the weekend. So the off-season training, again, it's first week in August to end of November, is about 18 weeks. They'll be training 4 days a week, primarily Monday, Tuesday, having an off day Wednesday, and getting back to it Thursday, Friday. So the goal during this time is to build that strength they'll need while they're on the board, again, be able to perform the tricks, move their body how they want while they're up in the air, while they're on the water, and just being able to kind of get that strength so that they're able to perform what they need to do when they need to do it. So right after off-season, again, I said in-season is going to be the longest season. It's about 5 months. So right off the bat, they're going to take the first 2 weeks of August after they just got off-season off, just to let their body recover a little bit. But then they come about 5 months of just constant pounding on the leg, the knees, ankles, their back. Now, they might not take it completely off. They might do some pickup basketball games, just go swimming in a pool, and just do some leisurely activities so they're not being completely sedentary. But they're not going to have any prescribed programs just so, again, they have that time to recover and to come down off that adrenaline rush that they've been on for the last 5 months. And then this season will be run in 4 week training blocks. So the 4 weeks, maybe focusing on their landing, focusing on the box jumps, getting quick, reactive, explosive. Next week we'll add maybe a little bit of weight, adding some squats with some weight, maybe throwing in some bench, some power moves in. The preseason training will be the beginning of December through the last week in January. So maybe about a 2-month, 9-week period. They'll be training 3 days a week. Here we're kind of getting them ready for their in-season training. So that's, again, they're about to go into 5 months of constant training. So we're kind of building them up off their off-season, preparing their bodies more for that constant training and competing they're about to be doing. So the goal will be to build muscular endurance, continue their strength, and add a little bit of power. So again, that muscular endurance is going to be important. You need to be able to hold onto the rope, perform these tricks for about a minute and a half, which may not seem like much with watching, but feel like an eternity when you're on the boat. Can't let go of the rope, have to stay in that solid athletic position, knees bent, ready to jump, and all that twisting in the air adds up over time. So the power, again, we're going to slightly add now. That'll be more towards the end of this 3 week period, or 9 week period, so more towards the last 3 week block. So that's just going to be starting to add maybe some very light Olympic movements. We're not going to focus on catching the bar, we'll be mostly just getting some high pulls in, maybe just some basic pulls from the ground or high pulls. They don't really need the bar to land on their shoulders. That's just kind of more impact that they don't need. This might also be just doing some bodyweight jump squats. Again, those box jumps from just using their bodyweight, getting used to moving that again. Here they might also add something like ankle weights to their leg raises. So that kind of simulates when they're in the air, they got to move that board. So it's extra added weight to their legs that they're not used to moving. So just kind of get their body used to what they'll be like in competition. And then their in-season training, so the first full week in February, the last weekend in July. Again, this is about 25 weeks. They'll be in training 2 to 3 times a week, depending on when they have a competition. If it's that Saturday, Sunday, maybe they can get an extra lift in on a Friday, real quick, right before they go in. Sometimes they'll be limited to 2, depending on when they have to leave. Maybe they'll take a week off, just because you don't want to be competing every weekend for 25 weeks. And that'll be a good time to get an extra lift in. So the goal here is just to maintain that endurance.
questions far away.
So I have a good question. You kind of touched on this earlier. You're kind of talking about stability rather than mobility for the core. I feel like sit-ups and so on have become sort of unfashionable in today's day and age, but I feel like a sport like this could benefit more from that. What are your thoughts on that? I guess what percentage of each would you do?
So, like I said, I think it's kind of good. I like to keep sport-specific movements. Right? So I think sit-ups and all that are great for core and all that. Like I said, I've had like leg raises because that's kind of a sport-specific movement. When they're out there, they're going to be lifting their legs with a twist. They're turning their upper body, lower body, and keep that movements. But there might be a time, like I said, when they're up in the air, they might have to bring the lower body down to get a good turn. So that would be something I would consider adding, kind of just depending on what their routine is. Maybe if they like to stay straight or mat flips, then maybe stick with like the twists, the planks. But if they're dipping a lot, then yeah, I would definitely add some of those in to get some of what they're doing for kind of training for.
With the fact that their feet are fixed, their ankle joint is kind of fixed within the boot itself on the board, any considerations with that in terms of your traditional triple extension exercises you extend through the ankle? Is that something that you would have less of an emphasis on with your movement patterns in the weight room, or do you still feel like that's important to the athletic literacy of those athletes anyway?
I think it's something I would still focus on. I mean, if you're training for it, it's hard to keep it clean just moving at your knees and hips, the shoulders, and keeping your ankles flat. So I think that's something that's going to come naturally and perform anyway, so I wouldn't stop them from doing it. It's not something I would overly emphasize, but like I said, if they're going over the weights and they're going to jump, their body's just going to naturally move, and if the kind of boosts that they have to connect them to the board are keeping them on there, it's just going to limit their mobility, so they might get as far as they can and jump, and then they're going to lift off, and that's just what's going to happen. So it's just, I wouldn't focus on keeping your ankles like in a certain position while lifting. I think it's also good to have that mobility in case of something like a crash. Maybe the board's going to twist one way, you want as much mobility as you can to keep your tendons from tearing anything from spraining. So I think I would add, or maybe not overemphasize the ankle mobility, but add some in there just so they're ready for anything.
Good. No questions as of right now on Facebook, so we'll call it there and then move on to the next one. Good job. Oh, hold up. Wait a second. Jamie was just writing. Jamie Oxenwald. All right. Jamie says, what are some specific grip strength exercises that those athletes might need to do?
Too tight on everything, that's definitely something that could affect their performance. So you can't overemphasize their